Hello, everyone. Welcome to our very special, we're not muted, cool, very special Cyberpunk Red episode. Nobody's in their right place because I didn't fix the cameras ahead of time. So nobody's gonna be in their right place for tonight. And well, we're gonna live with it. That's what we're gonna do. How about that?
So, your choice, your channel.
Yeah. Tonight's going to be a very, very calm, very relaxed character creation session. We're going to be remaking our characters from season one. And chat, I will need your help to create a... Hello, chat. To create a new character. We'll create an NPC together. So, to answer chat's question, it is not properly a session zero. We've already been playing this game for, what now, 12 sessions? 12, 16 weeks? Something like that? 14 weeks. So, yeah, it's just we were using the Jumpstart Kit rulebook, and now we're going to be using the full rules. So we're going to be converting these characters. But also, we're also going to be creating a new one from scratch. We're going to be taking questions from chat from time to time. This stream might go on a tiny bit longer than necessary. We'll talk about that after break. We do not have a giveaway this time, but we'll see about doing some more giveaways for season two. So just before we jump into the whole character creation session and all that, I would just like to thank all of our sponsors here at Wandering DM, beginning with Arthalsorian Games. It would not have been possible to do this without Talsorian's support. And I cannot thank them enough for trusting us with this document and to allow us to not only play this game since they made it, but also to be able to do what we're doing tonight. Our other sponsor tonight is, of course, Roll20, the virtual tabletop that you can check out using the torch down below. The die icon. Roll20.net is a virtual tabletop that we use here on Wandering DM to play all of our games. They have the Cyberpunk Jumpstart character sheets, which we've been using for the whole entirety of season one. So if you want to play Cyberpunk remotely during these troubled times, check out roll20.net. Our other sponsors is, Maygen Press, makers of 5th edition D&D supplements. Check them out at store.maygenpress.com. You can even use code WanderingDM to get 15% off everything you purchase, including the new book, Fantastic Felines, which is all about cats, cat monsters, and cat pun-based monsters. Our last partner... no, that's not true. Found familiar. I forgot about the coffee, because I'm not drinking coffee tonight. So, yeah. Found Familiar is makers of delicious coffee. You can check them out at foundfamiliar.com. And you can even use code WanderingDM to get 10% off your purchases. And if you order for $50 of coffee or more, you get free shipping if you live in the continental United States. And lastly, our partners through the Diceomancy program, Level Up Dice. Check them out, the Purple Torch, down below, or the link in chat. They are makers of fancy, fancy dice made out of stone, semi-precious stone, or metal. We are also very close to becoming a second-level Diceomancer, which is like their reward program. We get experience for every click on the link. So if you have time to spare tonight during the stream, just click on the link. Everything that we get through this program, we give back to our viewers in the form of giveaways. We've already given away a set of chip hematite dice, and the next one is going to be three sets of branded D6s. So, let's get into it. Let's talk about character creation. I would like to introduce our cast of players. We'll go around the table. Tell us who you are, the character that you are going to be making tonight, and in a sentence or two, who they are, so that everyone gets an idea of what the concept is for your character. We'll go around clockwise on the overlay. We'll probably do clockwise a lot or counterclockwise tonight. So we'll begin first with Chris.
Hey, everyone. My name is Chris Geary. You can find my Twitter handle underneath the amazing Anino, who's in the other cool hat. Right below Rin, who's in the third cool hat for the evening. So I am playing on season one and season going into season two. Mr. White, sort of a fixer, more of a networker. Day job is that of a trauma team surgeon. So he's actually a med tech who seems to know a lot of people based on, the lives that he's saved. And we're going to kind of see that dual personality come out in a variety of ways as we go through character creation.
Next up is Adelaide.
I'm Adelaide Gardner. That's O Adelaide on Twitter. I play Reno, our solo, who in season one was pretty beat up, burnt out, former employee of IEC. She got into some trouble when she discovered some information that IEC was hiding, and they promptly gave her the boot, beat her up, ripped all her implants out, so she deals with a lot of chronic migraines that are only now recently being fixed. She finally feels like she might be back in the driver's seat now with the destruction of IEC. They killed her boyfriend, set it up as a not a murder but a suicide, and has been dealing with that. So she's feeling a little good, I think. Feeling a little successful, I guess. Maybe a little bit back to normal. I am 1/4 of a team called Action Fiction. We create tabletop role-playing games. I'm currently developing a new one right now called Anomaly. So go check that out on our Twitter, Action Fiction.
Next up is Deirdre.
Oh, hey, y'all. You know me. I'm at Deirdre Donlin on Twitter, or PraxicalAthesmiaphoria, as you see me around on Twitch. And I play Chins, our wonderfully excitable, lovely, colorful mechanic who does nothing wrong whatsoever and just enjoys everything and fixing things. And she's the nicest person, and you should totally not blame her that it was not her fault that those four guys in the security team died because they, you know, we're in the way of a rocket launcher. That's not her
favorite thing is giving Reno headaches.
I mean,
that's her favorite thing to do.
It's not my fault. I like to fix things and make them better. And
or blow them up.
Or blow them up. That's a side effect. Those are both, you know, equal and opposite reactions, right? She is our tech mechanic. Grew up in Night City, kind of friendly with the cops because she needed a job after things went wrong with her own mechanic shop and her brother was in prison. And now he's not in prison. He's just crashing in the apartment that she's knocked a wall through to connect the two. Hey, she's now owns 1/5 of this building. It's not a problem
I'm
anymore.
I'm still the superintendent.
And I fix everything in this building, so.
So that would bring us to another tenant of the building, Anino.
How's it going, everybody? My name is Anino. I use he, him pronouns. For this campaign, I play Carlton Ray Jepson Bautista, better known as Jimenez. He is a professional wrestler, so built off the Rocker Boy archetype. He's a pretty chill character, but he plays a very intense wrestler. He's very passionate about the industry and is sort of on his way to the top.
And last but not least, Rin.
Hey, I'm Rin at Heaven's Night on Twitter and Burns Through the Rain in Twitch chat. I play Jinx, the nomad. Basically, she grew up with her family on the roads, her home was basically her bike. And unfortunately, something happened to them, and she ended up coming to Night City and started living here. And now she works more as a mercenary while trying to find those who unfortunately caused harm to her family. And yeah, she likes guns. Guns are good. Bikes are good. And she likes doing the odd jobs and helping people out. I think that's it.
And tonight we're going to be creating together with chat a character as we go around the table and do the life paths and roles and stats for everyone one by one. But I'm also going to need your help, chat, and we're going to start with a question for all of you. I need a number between 1 and 5. Give me a number between 1 and 5. That'll determine the role that we are going to be creating tonight. So it'll be one of the role that hasn't been chosen by the players. I see a lot of threes. I see a lot of fours. All right. You know what? I'm going to go... Let's go with three then. Oh, that's an awful lot of five. Jesus. Yeah, I could also roll a d5, but like that gives less chance for chat to do anything.
I think they were actually trying to use a Nightbot function.
Oh.
Does Nightbot have that function to just roll it in chat?
If it does, backslash? I don't.
You have to program it.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
But all right, let's go with number three, which means we are going to create a lawman together. So let's create the law.
I hate him already.
Why? You like Uncle Al, don't you?
I was going to say, are you statting out Uncle Al?
I'm anti-authority.
Uncle Al is the one exception, okay? And even then, it's a thin line, okay?
RoboCop's gone mad. The thing is about John McClane is that there is actually a... Uncle Al is Al Powell from Die Hard because Trince is a big Die Hard fan. And so is Deirdre. And thus, a lot of her character backstory and everything mimics certain aspects of the Die Hard trilogy. Her phone, her agent, the AI that's inside, is called Hans Gruber.
He looks like Hans Gruber,
but he's called Benedict.
Yes.
So, yeah. So we're going to be creating... So... Yeah?
I love Renegade's suggestion. If we... I don't know. Will the world survive if we have both... Al Powell and John Riggs in the same universe?
We'll
or would
see.
It just implode from awesomeness?
Riggs or Murdo. Yeah.
No, actually, Al Powell is legitimately the sergeant in charge of the motor pool at NCPD, according to this canon.
Yeah. Okay, so the first thing we're going to do tonight, before moving on to life paths, we're going to be looking at our stats. So, with the full character creation rule, you have 10 stats. Intelligence, reflex, dex, tech, cool, will, luck, move, body, and empathy. And you have... we're using, by the way, because... so that's one thing that you need to know. In Cyberpunk Red, there are three ways to generate your character. There's a pre-gen method. There's the full customizable thing, which we're going to use tonight. And then there's an in-between... the McCaslin method, which basically is not completely pre-gen, but is an easier and faster way to build characters than to go into the full point-buy method. What we're going to do tonight is we're going to place... So begin by placing the 62 points among your stats. Because those characters are already made, what I told my players beforehand is we had rolled the stats... in season one. So what we're going to do is we're going to check if these stats go above 62. or if an individual stat goes above an 8. If that's the case, we're going to lower them to an 8, add them all together, look at if we reach 62 or not. If we're under 62, well, you get 3 points to put in. If you're above 62, then we're going to need to bring those stats down to match the 62 stat array. For the characters that we're creating tonight, chat, they're going to have 6 in all of their stats, plus 2 stats that are going to be at 7. I would like to know where to put those 2 points. So while everyone is doing their stats, feel free to post in chat, which stat do you think our law person tonight should have? For the rest of the crew, was that well explained enough? So let me know when you're done with the stats on your end. I see you, reflex and body. Cool and reflex. Can I test if the Moobot roll works? You can try, but I'm not using Moobot, so. Cool and reflex, cool and reflex, 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 buddy, reflex, reflex, cool. I think we're gonna go with some cool and some reflex. It's gonna be a cool, quick on the trigger lawman.
And our stats can't be above an 8 as well, correct?
Yeah, except for that plus 1 bonus that I gave all of you that you can bring a stat to a 9 with, but that we're gonna do after the 62 points.
Okay. So for now, just set up for 8.
Yeah.
Got it.
All right, so while the players are still tweaking their stats, chat, let's lower one of our law person's stat to a 4 and boost another one. I'll boost both reflex and cool with those 2 bonus points. Which stat should be our dump stat for our law person? Which one do you think should be the worst?
Intelligence.
Someone's saying tech, intelligence, tech, intel, tech, cool, intel. I got 3 tech, 3 intel, 4. He's a cop, right? Yeah, he is. Or she is. We don't know. They are for the moment. Tech, luck, or luck. If he was smart, he'd be a solo. All right, so we're gonna lower tech to a 5 and intelligence to a 5 to please everyone, and we're gonna bring reflex up to an 8 and cool up to an 8, which means that we have 5, 8, 6, 5, 8, 6, 6, 6, 6, 6. Ludite cup. Yeah, luck is always a dumb stat until you realize that you actually need it. I have seen some witchers in my Witcher campaigns rue the day that they've put a 2 in luck and not have any more points to shove
in there.
I had
a 2 in luck.
Yeah.
I'm bumping it up now only because of the events of Season 1. I would have otherwise kept it a 2.
Okay.
Gotta stay on brand, you know?
You let the gods determine your luck. Yep. Sometimes the gods are fickle. Very fickle. Tech value are the ones of the Netwatch. Yeah. In this instance, what we don't have is the in-depth rules for net running. So while we can create a netrunner tonight, they don't have anything special because I don't have the definition of all of their abilities. So, Ludite cop who cosplays as a Wild West gunslinger. I mean, I feel like that should be some sort of poser gang. Of, like, called the West Fargos or something. Cast, what about your stats?
I'm good. Ready. I get to add 8 more points to mine.
All right.
Mine was really below 62.
So, would you care to let people know what your stats are like at the moment so they can have an idea of the different arrays that you can have with the 62 points. And we'll begin this time with Chris.
All right. So Mr. White has an 8 intelligence, 4 reflexes, 6 dexterity, an 8 tech, a 7 cool, 7 will, 5 luck, 3 move, 7 body, 7 empathy.
Hmm.
He walks or takes a taxi or has his trauma team driver take him places.
That is true. That is very reflective of what happened in season one.
He has never once moved like something mattered.
Yep.
All game. So move became my dump stat.
That works.
And reflexes, I mean, heck, even when I had a 6 reflex before, I couldn't hit the broadside of a barn. So I might as well just drop it to a 4 and call it a day.
All right, then. Adelaide.
Yeah, so I have a 6 in intelligence, an 8 in reflexes, an 8 in dexterity, a 5 in tech, a 6 in cool, not because she's very charismatic, but she is kind of intimidating. An 8 in will, because she's gone through some tough shit. A 4 in luck. A 6 in move. A 7 in body. And 4 in empathy.
That's going to be interesting.
Yeah, I've had a fun, it's been a fun season one with these stats, because they were a lot lower in season one. I think when we went through the process with Simon and me the first time I was building her, I actually built her higher and then lowered it after our one shot where she was essentially kind of ripped to shreds as kind of an acknowledgement of her more like almost disabled body. She's definitely disabled in a lot of ways, like physically and mentally. So it was fun. It was a really fun process of lowering the stats to where they might be more accurate.
Because of all the damage that you suffered.
Definitely a hurdle to get past with rolling.
Yeah. Trins.
So Trins actually was below 62 points at the beginning of this. So she got to go up a couple places and she had to move a couple things down to change things around. So she ends up with a 7 intelligence, an 8 in reflex, because we're all hoping that she doesn't get shot anymore.
It's not going to happen. We're still, if she doesn't get shot, we'll just shoot her. It's fine.
But that's dexterity to evade.
Yeah, evasion is dexterity, not reflex.
Reflex is to shoot.
Yes, I understand. That's why I could bring her dex up to a 7. There are other things in reflexes. Because the reflex
driving.
Is important. Driving.
Because she's the driver. Yeah.
One of the two drivers. The other driver is Rin. You know, she may or may not have liberated some cars from their previous owners at various points in time. So her dex is 7, her tech is 8, her cool I brought up to a 6, which is good. Her will is a 6. I brought her luck up to a 5 because you know what? She was got really lucky in that finale and didn't get shot and got to do some cool stuff. And then her move, I brought up to a 5 because she learned to get the out of way gunshots, hopefully. And body is a 5 and her empathy is a 5. Because she's kind of empathetic and nice and she likes people, but I don't think she really gets people all the time.
Hmm.
Mood.
Anino.
So Jimenez is actually kind of the physical, like hand-to-hand combat specialist within the group. And it's I think it saved the group in a number of occasions when their guns were not very accurate. But being a rocker boy, he also needs to have some pretty good social skills. So Stats go 4 for intelligence, 6 for reflexes, 7 for dexterity, 3 for tech. Cool is 8, will is 7, luck is 7, move is 6, body is 9, and empathy is 6.
9 because you put your plus 1 in it?
That's right.
Okay. Everybody else, did you put your plus 1 that I've given you? That I had given you?
No, not yet.
Okay. Then once we're done like explaining the stats, go ahead and put your plus 1. And what about you, Rin?
Okay, so intel 7, reflex 8, dex 8, tech 5, cool 6, will 7, luck 3, move 7, body 7, and empathy 4. Yeah. That's what you got.
Now, the next step in character creation should be skills. The way skills work in Cyberpunk Red is that you have 86 skill points to put in any skill that you want, except for the roles. We'll see them later. No skill can be raised higher than a 6. However, there's a handful of skills that you have to put at level 2 to begin with. So theoretically, while you do have 86 skill points to raise up any skills you want, in reality, you have 60 points to create your character, because those 26 other points are going to be shared with athletics, brawling, concentration, conversation, education, evasion, first aid, human perception, language, street slang, local expert, wherever you live, perception, persuasion, and stealth. And again, there are some skills on the character sheets. The players have it that have cost 2 points to increase by 1 level. So I will let you players spread out your points among the skills that you had. Prof Richter, it's 62 attribute points. I gave a free one to my players because of their level up. So it's 62 and 86.
86 points for skills, you said?
Well, it's 60, and then what I'll do is I'll copy-paste something for you in our Discord, in our Zoom chat.
I was going to say, can you give me that first? Because that's going to help me.
Yeah.
If I see that first.
All the skills I put in Zoom chat, those ones all start at 2.
Automatically.
And then you have 60 points to spread amongst all the the skills.
60 points. Okay.
Yeah.
Should we do the derived stats?
We'll do derived after.
Cool.
So for our law person, I'm not going to go and list all of the skills because that would be, John, they are not called career skills. That is done with. They are actually just a bunch. So these skills, is just a bunch of skills that every human has that should be at level 2. Because no one is completely inept in those skills. So everyone can walk, everyone can jog, everyone can run, well, to a certain extent. So everyone has a 2 in athletics. Now it depends on physically if you're able to or not. That becomes another question. But if you're like able-bodied and everything, you should have a 2 in athletics. That's true. It's not everyone. But yes. It's what people would have called everyman's skill. Yeah, if you're an able-bodied person, you should have like 2 in those skills. Like drive through RPG. So for our law person, what we're going to do is we're going to tweak them a bit, because we could go through all the skills and like min-max a law person, but that, what's the fun in it? Instead, we're going to create some weird amalgamation of skills So what we're going to do is, since we have 60 points, we're going to create 10. Oh, skills cannot be higher than a 6. Remember, when you create a character, no higher than 6. So you need a story for why they have those skills. Yep. That is true, RoboCop. I never thought I'd say that before. But yes, normally you would have to have a reason why you have those skills. That is not a house rule, John John. It's in the core rule book. No starting stat can be above than an 8, and no starting skill can be above a 6. It is reminiscent of the character creation rules in The Witcher. So I feel like The Witcher was sort of a testing grounds for some of the rules that they wanted to insert into Cyberpunk Red. So friends, chat, Chumbas, can you give me a number between 1 and 20, please? That's going to be an intelligence skill that our law person has. So, nice. And what I'll do is, I am not going to look at chat for a moment. I'll just do like this, not look at chat. And in a moment, I will remove my hand, look at chat, and the first number I see is the skill that our lawman is going to have 6 points in. 17. And 17 is... where's my character sheet? 20, 19, 18, 17. A science. Ooh. What's our law person specialized in under science? Forensic. Yeah, that makes sense. Forensic sciences. Our other... they're a CSI. They're probably a CSI. We'll see. Can you give me another number between 1 and 9? Any number between 1 and 9. Hello, Phantom Roll Booth. Hello, Cypher. Not looking at chat. Number between 1 and 9. And this one, 4. That's a reflex skill. 1, 2, 3, 4. Handgun. Our law person has a 6 in handguns.
Welcome, everybody.
Welcome to all of you. Is that... do we have a raid? No, there's just a bunch of people. Hi.
I have a question for you. There is, on the reflex skills, there is a handgun.
Yes.
And there is heavy weapons.
Yeah.
But there's nothing for, like, the in-between.
It's shoulder arms.
Is that shoulder arms? Like an assault rifle would be a shoulder arm?
Yeah, anything that you would put against your shoulder to fire is called shoulder arms.
I see. That makes sense. Okay. I'm thinking like a bazooka, but I guess I would need it. It's like, well, I don't really use those.
Not yet. And yes, there are skills on the character sheets that are marked with a little 2. Just like in The Witcher, that means it's a 2 for 1. So if you want to put 1 rank in it, you have to spend 2 points. They're like twice as expensive.
Trins has never fired a bazooka in her life. She has, however, fired a modified rocket launcher that came out of a fire extinguisher, and somebody else handed her a rocket launcher that she just fired down a hallway.
That is true.
There was no bazookas in her life. But if Reno wants to get her one...
We'll see.
I just let you get a puppy, okay? I'm not letting you get a bazooka. That's... lines have to be drawn.
Hey, chat, I need a number between 1 and 8 for our dexterity skill. Number between 1 and 8. Not looking at chat. So, the skills under dex are pretty much what you would expect of skills, though some are interesting. Martial arts, for example, is an interesting one. And 2. What was number 2? Number 2 was brawling. We're going to up brawling to 6. That's going to give us an extra 2 points somewhere to do something with. But yes, our law person right now is good in forensic sciences, handguns, and brawling. Cyber kick head off. Yeah. Oh, we're going to come back to mental skills, Robocop. I would need... I just want to put, like, numbers here and there. In cool, can you choose another... Let's say, also four. There you go. So, under cool, number four, one, two, three, four. Personal grooming. Interesting. Grooming is at a six. It's a very good-looking law person. Or at least they know how to groom themselves. Let's give them skill in will and empathy, and then we'll go back to intelligence and reflex and dex, because I feel like those two, those three could be important to them. So will, I just need a number between one and three. So just a number between one and three. Looking. Number two. Number two is endurance. Endurance at six. And is our law person a good conversationalist or good at human perception? What do you think? Should we go human perception and be able to have some insight into people's motives? Or are we more of a conversationalist? Or are we good at both? Everyone's going human perception. All right, so we're going to be creating someone who can read a room. They're awkward, but they can read people. Sure. Let's go back to Intel, Reflex, and Dex. Yeah, give me another number between 1 and 20. We'll do that. Just any number between 1 and 20. That is, at worst, if it's already chosen, I'll skip over. But not looking, 11. 11. 11 is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. Oh, gamble. Our law person is also a gambler. All right, let's do another reflex. No, I feel like reflex is okay. Let's do dex and intelligence again. So I'll take another number between 1 and 20. I'll take number 7. What's number 7? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Criminology. That seems to work. No, that's a 16. We have 16 points left. What about a dexterity skill? A number between 1 and 8. A number between 1 and 8. Poker is perfect for a lab rat who reads people but doesn't like to talk. Yeah. All right, number 5. We'll go for number 5 in dexterity. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Evasion. Good for them. Good at evading. We technically have 2 skills left. We have 12 points left to put. I feel like we should do cool and technique again. Tech, we haven't done so. And cool, I feel like we could probably have another cool skill in there that could be like streetwise or bribery or interrogation, trading, something like that. I think that we should put some points in maybe in technique, just to see like something special that comes out of the left field that we do not expect. Could you give me a number between 1 and 17? A number between 1 and 17. Oh, shit, not looking at chat. While chat is posting numbers, players, are you okay so far?
So, I noticed that play instrument basically got shifted under technique. So, I'm wondering...
Oh, because in your case, it's no longer like a class skill.
Okay.
So if you wanted to represent the same presence, like stage presence that you used to have, you could go with something under cool like acting or maybe wardrobe and style.
Okay.
To represent how, because we used to say play instrument because it was like one of the only skills that we had. Sure. But now that we have access to them all, I figure in my mind, if I imagine Jimenez getting on stage and being announced by the announcers, I figure wardrobe and style is probably what people are going to look at first. How cool do you look? And then how can you sell it? That would probably be in acting.
Okay.
That makes a lot of sense, actually.
Number 16 for our tech skill, that's picklock. Oh. And another number between 1 and 8, please, and that's going to be it. No, John, the rocker boy is not limited to strictly music. You can be a poet, you can be a visual artist, you could be a DJ, you can be a K-pop idol, you can be... No, that's true, it's number 10. You can be a comedian, political, you can be a writer, you can be a performance artist, you can be a wrestler. So it's rocker boy is now anything that is taking an art style, like a very entertainment, I should say. Approach to life. So number 3. Let's go with number 3. 1, 2, 3. Interrogation. We said we didn't want interrogation, so I'll take another one. Alright. 5. What's number 5 again? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Persuasion. They're very persuasive. Will we see the full skills list in this stream? Well, because our second season is going to be played using these full rules, yes, over the course of the stream, the game, you will see a broad range of skills being used. However, I don't think I am allowed to post the full skill list in chat or anything. What I can say, however, is I could tell you that they are pretty much the same skills from 2020. Looking quickly at the list... there are a few that I don't remember if they were in 2020. Auto fire is one that I don't recall if it was in 2020 or not. But now there's a skill specifically for auto firing with an automatic weapon. Contortionist is another one. El Sofian, we're still in it. It was a mechanic, but not a skill. Yeah, that's it. Autofire wasn't there. Now, all the basic tech from the Jumpstart Kit has been split into air vehicle, basic, electronic, land vehicle and sea vehicle and weapons deck. I don't remember if photograph and filming was a skill, if filming was a skill in 2020. You still have wardrobe and style. You still have personal grooming. Rifles are now shoulder arms. So anything shotgun, rifle goes into shoulder arms. And I think that's it. Cryptography, I think, was absent from the older one as well, from 2020. Photo and film definitely was. Okay. Yeah, so there are a total of, let me check, 20, 29, 29, 49, 49 plus 2, that's 51, 67 skills in all. Yeah, so 67 skills in Cyberpunk Red. Lockpicking exists, and I think that electronic lockpicking, let me check the definition of lockpicking. It's either the same thing, so lockpicking goes for electronic as well, or it's been merged into electronic tech. Yeah, pick lock is for non-electronic locks and non-electronic security countermeasures, and under tech, electronic security is to counter, repair, understand, identify anything that is electronic based. So any electronic device. So in this case, you would lockpick an old lock, like a padlock. But you would, if you were faced with, let's say, a retinal scanner, that would be electronic tech that you would need. Jury rig is not a skill. I know that the tech has an ability now, a role ability, to jury rig something and repair it in a round. We'll get to that once we get later into character creation and we hit the role skills for everyone. Electronic lockpick is tech-based. And lockpick is also tech-based. They're RoboCop. They're both under technique now.
So, my question is, when would you use martial arts versus brawling?
Good question. Let me check for a quick second. Brawling is just a wail at people.
And grappling, I assume.
And grappling. Mind you, I, as a GM, would say some martial arts are based around grappling and throwing people, like judo.
Sure.
So I would allow grappling through martial arts. As far as what the game does with it, this is a question we can ask Jay. But I do believe that it would affect the damage that you do. Because some cyber implants require you, like Big Nux, you're going to fight with brawling.
Yeah.
With Big Nux.
That's what it does on my sheet.
Yeah. You're not going to fight with martial arts. What's the upside of taking martial arts? We're going to have to ask Jay for that. I'm basing myself on games such as like D20 Modern or World of Darkness, where martial arts does lethal damage, for example, versus brawling that only hits into someone's like stamina, for example. But because we only have card gen and we don't have like the fighting rules and everything, we are probably allowed a few questions to our Talsorian, which we'll ask, but I cannot guarantee that we'll get the answer. Yeah. So you're not spending any of these skill points for role abilities. No, role abilities are completely separate in character creation. You begin the game with 4 ranks in your role ability, and you decide what you want to do with those 4 ranks. Some, and we'll see later, some roles have like a tech tree, so they can like add points here and there. Others, it's just a single thing, and you put points in there, and that's what it is. Yeah, John, when you start your character, you get 4 ranks in your role, and that's it. You have to level them up after, from what I've been told by RTG. Yeah. So that's also different from The Witcher, in which you could put some of your points in and begin with a role that's higher than 4, or 0, or 1, or however many points you decided to put in it. In this case, it's everyone starts at 4. And you'll see, I'll go into like an example with our lawman, that a rank 1 in a roll ability is not all that great. Like a rank 1 in a rocker boy is like you have 1 fan and it's your mom. And that's it. So 4 ranks is enough to say that you can make a living out of it. Does it differ depending on type of start? Because I remember you could choose the type of start and get different amounts of points to sell. Yeah, so Albiro Alpha, we're doing the one where you get to choose and customize everything, the full package that they call. The other methods are more pre-built. We don't have access to those at the moment. We're only, the document that we've been given only has the whole thing, the whole point buy full customization that the other two don't offer. That's sweet. You might be a rank 1 rocker boy. Oh, the amount of points in point buy. No, the amount of points seems to be the same for everything. And we'll talk about interface later, but yeah, it's, what was I going to say? I was going to say a thing. Yeah, the amount of points in point buy. No, it seems like 86 points is what everyone gets for point buy. To answer your favorite commissar, and please don't shoot me, but yes, they said that the game was going to be pushed back. Unfortunately, due to the circumstances, it was announced today on the Artalsorian blog that the game is going to be delayed. Instead of June, we're talking about probably end of summer, because of everything that's been happening. It's just, yes, there's a lot of wailing on our part, but we're gonna still play with the rules that we have. And the jumpstart rules are good enough. I mean, we tweak them to be able to play with like this group to do the whole first session, and it seemed like okay enough to use. Otherwise, you can still go back to CP 2020 in the meantime. People who play this way already, yeah. Right before 2077. Yeah, basically. It is more balanced. I feel compared to 2020, the Cyberpunk Red versions feels a lot more balanced already. Players, are you somewhat done with your skills? I would just like to know, what's your highest, what's your lowest? Not in rating, but the skill itself. What are you good at? What are you bad at? Let's do counterclockwise and begin with Jinx.
Okay. What I'm really good at. Okay. I put 6 in drive land vehicle, in shoulder arms, and in stealth. Yeah. What I'm bad at. I put a 2 in basic tech and streetwise and first aid. I put a 2. Maybe I'll know how to put like one little bandage if ever Mr. Wright's not there around. Yeah, and everything else is pretty average, I would say. Yeah.
All right. Jimenez.
So, so my highest skills right now are acting, persuasion, and wardrobe and style, which are all 6s. Athletics and brawling are both at 6s. What I plan on doing is really going to be dependent on what the rules are surrounding martial arts exactly. But he is very specialized and focused, so he's probably not going to have a whole lot of skills in either intelligence or technique. Mm. So that's where I'm at right now.
Okay. What about Trins?
So Trins is good at certain things and she's not good at a lot of other things. If it's tech-based, she's probably good at it. Basic tech, air vehicle tech, land vehicle tech, weapons tech. She's only got a 4 in cyber tech because, you know, it was more expensive and those are harder to deal with. She's only got a 2 in sea vehicle tech because, you know, she's lived in Night City her entire life, and so there's kind of a port, but there was a giant nuclear explosion there before she was born, so, you know, not staying there. She can drive really well, but everything, you know, she's not that good at... She has education at a 5, but she doesn't know any like specialty skills and intelligence. That's not her deal. And she's kind of persuasive and kind of streetwise, but that's about it.
Your favorite commissar, the document that we're using at the moment is a secret document that Talsorian shared with us. It is not going to be published, not as far as I'm concerned. They haven't told us anything of the sort. If they do wish to release part of the Cyberpunk Red rules at some point, then they're free to do so. It's not like we haven't been told anything. Reno.
Yeah, so Reno is your pretty standard tough girl. She graduated high school, the equivalent, and that's about it. So I have literally nothing in intelligence. I put in some stuff into local expert for my home because she is pretty paranoid and keeps tabs on the neighborhood goings on. And of course, tactics and tracking and perception. My highest stats, of course, are in your dexterity category. So athletics, brawling, evasion, melee weapons. She's good with guns too. But she has a metal arm, big knucks, and she likes to box. So that's what she does best. Get up close and personal.
And Mr. White.
Well, what he's not good at goes with his dump stat. Not his dump stat because that's move. But reflexes of 4. So reflexes, I don't have any. I didn't put any points in any of the stuff in there. However... He does have, I put points into his surgery skill, and that one's going to be maxed out between that and his roll ability. Education's maxed out. Local expert's maxed out. And then a couple others are super close. Paramedic, trading, everything else is kind of in the middle. In different areas for different strategic things that he does. So persuasion is a 4, concentration and endurance and resist torture drugs are all 3s. Cyber tech is a 4. He also has science neurology at a 3. because that's been a something that he has been working on from more of the theoretical side than the practical side.
Mm-hmm. Theoretical neurology, basically.
Yeah.
Now that
I have
that's
a theoretical degree in neurology.
Now the other part is what we call the life path. Life path is a series of tables that you can bring your character through to determine what their background is. The thing is, for our group, backgrounds and everything has already been established using both the life paths from the Jumpstart kit and also just freeform role-playing. So, of course, we're not going to completely redo the characters and change all of their background because of that and everything. But we are going to roll a few life paths tonight. We're going to start with the one with our lawmen, then go to break, and come back with a few other examples. So to begin with our law person, I would need a number between 1 and 11. So if you can give me a number between 1 and 11, that'll determine their general cultural group. I'm gonna hide chat. 1 and 11. Yep. 9. Number 9, which means that they are Central or South American. So, South American lawmen. What about their personality? I will pick another number for their personality. I will pick number 2 for their personality. Their personality is rebellious, antisocial, and violent. A rebellious... Oh my god, it's a rebellious cop. We're building Murtaugh and whatchamacallit. I would need another number between 1 and 10 for clothing, hairstyle, and affectations. So clothing is basically basic. It's how they dress. Hairstyle is... oh my god, thank you so much for all the gift subs. This is... Whoa. There's going to be a lot of alerts. I'm just saying. All right. 8, 6, and 3. Let's go with that. 8, 6, and 3. 8. They wear gang colors. Ooh, so maybe an undercover cop or something. They wear gang colors. 3. They wear their hair short and spiked. And 6. They have tongue or other piercings. Probably piercings that they should remove for the job, but they don't. I'll pick another number in chat. Number 8. Number 8. They're motivated by power. Their motivation is power. And how they feel about people is... Number 10. They feel that people are wonderful. So, to restate, South American lawmen, rebellious, wearing gang colors, with short and spiked hair, with a tongue or other piercings, motivated by power, and they think that people are wonderful. Chat, I would need 2 more numbers between 1 and 10. To determine the most valued person in their lives. The most valued person in their lives. And another number that will determine the most valued possession that they own. I'll just give you a quick second. Their most valued person in life and their most valued possession. 9 and 5. Let's go with that. 9 and 5. Most valued person is a personal hero. And their most valued possession is a book. And now that we have that, now it's when the life path goes into backstory. Where were you born? What were you doing before the game? What happened to you to make you the person that you are? So the first thing that we're going to check is a number between 1 and 10. I'll pick in the numbers that you've already given to determine where did this lawman come from? Number 8. This lawman comes from a megastructure Warren Rats. You grew up in one of the huge new megastructure that went up after the war. A tiny conopt, kibble and scop for food. A mostly warm bed. Some better educated adult Warren dwellers or a local corporation may have set up a school. So, grew up in a Warren. Not the best place to have grown up, necessarily. How did they grow up, though? What was the kind of place where you and your siblings hung out in? I'll pick another number. I'll pick number 1. Kibble is better than nothing. But with a number 1, they ran on the street with no adult supervision. This very cyber generation of them. Family crisis. In the time of the Red, the world is still recovering from World War and other disasters. Chances are, something happened to your family. What happened? Number 4. Your family is imprisoned and you alone escaped. That could be a powerful motivation for our law person. That their family was maybe wrongfully imprisoned. And they've joined with the law to try to find a way to clear their family of the name. Or, on the other hand, the family was imprisoned. They should have been imprisoned as well for whatever crime they've committed. But instead have decided to hide their past lives and just suddenly decide to go a cop to hide in plain sight, as it were. I'll pick another number from what you've given me. Number three, their only friend. Is a teacher or mentor. Of course, when you get the friends, you normally roll a d3 and you determine if you have between 1 and 3 friends. We're just going to take 1 for now. And we're going to do the same thing for the enemies. Could you give me, chat, 3 numbers between 1 and 10? Three numbers between 1 and 10. That'll determine who is our worst enemy. Three, 6, and 9. It's an estranged relative who turned down the cop, turned down the other's offer of a job or romantic involvement. And they can throw at you a powerful corporation. So there's an estranged relative from a powerful corp who is now our lawperson's enemy. And they can throw the full might of a corp behind them. And as far as the bad blood goes, let's go with number 7. They, if they see you on the streets, they will verbally attack you. They won't go any farther than that unless you push them. But this estranged relative is not going to go past verbal attacks against our cop. Probably slander in the daily scream sheets or something like that. It could be... Could be, if our law person is the hero of our campaign, that something's been happening to them, maybe that estranged relative got their family imprisoned and forced them to live in a warren as a warren rat growing up because they decided to take control of the family's businesses or wealth and throw everybody else on the street. So we still have three other numbers. I would need a, it's all 1 to 10. So I'll just pick from the numbers you gave me. But the first one is for a tragic love affair, because love affairs are tragic in the time of the Red. And, oh, hi, Jay. Welcome. Number two, 2, 4, and 7 for the next numbers. Our lawmen, too, their lover mysteriously vanished. This is like the starting case of a film noir or something. Their motivation is power. We've already established that before. So, and their life goal is to get what is rightfully theirs. So we have a South American law person, rebellious, wearing gang colors, with short and spiked hair, tongue or other piercings, motivated by power, who thinks that people are wonderful. They admire a personal hero. They have a book of names that we said was their favored, their most treasured possession. They grew up in a warren, running the streets with no adult supervision. Their family was in prison and them alone escaped. They value a teacher or mentor who is their friend. Their lover mysteriously vanished and they are out to get what is rightfully theirs. Now, this is the regular life path that everyone goes through, regardless of who you are. Now, there's also a special role life path. So that's a life path that is only for your role. And I would need a bunch of numbers between 1 and 6 to create the special lawman life path before we go to break. We've got 4, 6, 5. All right, let's go with that. Four, six, five, three. So 4. They work for the sheriff's department. Their position on the force is internal affairs. Their jurisdiction is in the recovery zone. Oh. Their group will occasionally slip and do unethical things, but it's rare. And now I'm missing 2 numbers. 2 and 4. Who's gunning for your group? Booster gangs. And who's your group's major target? Dirty politicians. So see, these are like the six questions that you can ask yourself as a lawman to determine where you're from and what you do and all that jazz. So our very rebellious lawman works in internal affairs, which is kind of funny, in the recovery zone, going after... who's gunning from your major target is politicians, corrupt politicians, booster gangs are after them, and they work for the sheriff's office. Of course, we're rolling randomly a character tonight. Some of the things might not make a whole lot of sense. But when that's the case, you know, that's when you just stop rolling and you just pick and choose what you want from the list. We're gonna go on a quick break. We'll be right back. When we come back, the group is gonna roll through another character to show another life path, another person that could be possible to be created with this set of rules. Stick around, everyone. Go get something to drink, something to eat. Stretch your legs. We'll be back in a couple of minutes. Hello, everyone. We're back. About to create another life path character. So what we'll do is we'll go around the table and in turn, we're either going to choose or roll on a table to create another, show you the some of the other aspects of the life paths that we haven't done. Got another question. Is transferring your consciousness from body to body a thing in Cyberpunk? As far as I know, not really. You can transfer your body, your mind to the net through the Soul Killer virus. But no, the Soul Killer takes your mind and then kills your body. And then your mind is trapped in the net. And then can be re-downloaded later, probably. But there's no like Altered Carbon where you can just, you know, reincarnate at will, if you will.
Yet. Once you figure out how to put that mind from the net into a chip and then slot it into somebody and kick out their old personality.
Yeah. Like right now you could infuse yourself in a robot, for example.
Yeah.
But yeah, we'll see. We'll see how that works. If you die, you die. Blame Mike Pondsmith. Yep. So. Mr. White. Chris. Why don't we kick off the life path with you?
Cool.
You can either roll or choose an ethnicity for a character.
I rolled a 4 in the roll 20.
All right, so they're
African. I feel like the randomness is fun.
All right, so it's an African, so either Bantu, Fante, Congo, Ashanti, Zulu, or Swahili. Well, that's their languages, sorry. Mm-hmm. But they're of African descent. Adelaide.
Her family is from England. They're immigrants.
They're immigrants, okay. And what is their personality like?
So her family is very traditional, suburban, middle-class family, pretty close. She is vaguely in touch with them, but still is a little bit paranoid to get in contact with family. So she just calls them whenever she feels she can.
Is this Reno or the character we're creating?
Talking about the character that we're creating.
Yeah, we're talking about the character you're creating.
Listen, okay.
I was like, wait a second.
Their personality
page 34
is, I'm on page 34, thank you. Let's see, their personality, they really love people, right? I'm gonna say they're very smart in how they approach people, but they're very friendly, almost like disconcertingly so. But they're very genuine about it. But they're smart. They're not, it's not just like they're a very naive kind of person.
Mm-hmm. Very approachable.
Very approachable.
Deirdre, what would be their clothing style, their hairstyle, and the affectations they are never without?
Okay, so for clothing, it's business wear, because I rolled for it. And we know me, I roll for everything. And their hairstyle is short and spiked with business wear. And the affectation they are never without. Roll 20 is rolling, so it's thinking. It's thinking. Oh, okay. Mirror shades. Business wear, short spiked hair, mirror shades.
Okay. Anino, what would be their motivation?
I'm going to say their motivation is love.
Motivation is love. And how do they feel about people?
They feel that every person is a valuable individual.
So approachable, business wear, shades. Everyone's valuable, motivated by love. Rin, what do they value the most and what is their most valuable possession?
I freaking... I'm going to say their most valued person is... I want to say their pet. And the possession will be a diary.
Let's now delve into their backstory. Chris, what kind of backstory do we give that character? What's their original background? Where do they come from?
Let's see here. We're going to just roll again because that's going to be fun here.
All right.
We got a 3. So corporate technician. Their middle class is their background. And they are trying to live better than their parents. Corporate, the business suit, trying to push past that.
Mm. Mm-hmm. What environment did they grow up in, Adelaide?
Let's say the floating offshore city that is a meeting place for all kinds of people. That sounds interesting. We haven't run into anyone of those yet, so.
That is true.
Go to that.
So their family came originally from the suburbs, and they left and grew up in a floating offshore city. Mm-hmm. Family crisis. What has happened to their family? Deirdre. You're muted.
Yeah, I just unmuted. I figured. Their family vanished. They're the only remaining member. No clue where they are. Just didn't come home one night. Sad.
What about, we're going to do only one friend, but what about their friend, Anino? Who's their friend?
Their friend. I think their friend's name is Taylor.
And what's their relationship to them?
They intern together at some megacorp.
Okay.
During college.
So like a coworker or something.
Yeah, something like that.
What about enemies? Rin, who's their enemy?
Person working for them.
And what caused it?
Accused. Wait, I gotta read this right. They accused our character of cowardice because, let's say, she didn't defend that worker. Yeah.
And what could they bring to bear if push come to shove?
Just themselves and maybe a close friend.
So it's like a personal feud. More than an all-out war. Sweet revenge, Chris. What's the worst that could happen if they finally meet face to face?
Let me unmute. Sweet revenge. I got a 5, so backstab them indirectly.
Talking back of them, stuff like that.
Or worse.
We have a tragic love affair. That's going to be our last one. Adelaide, what happened to their lover?
You know what? We're going to say their enemy, the rival, cut them out of the action.
Ooh.
As in, they stole your girl.
That's backstabbing indirectly. That works. Deirdre, what would be their role?
You know what? I'm going to make them a corp.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. So let's go with the exec. What would be, it's on page 48. What kind of corp are they working in? What do they do? You're muted.
Wow, I'm so smart, y'all. Hashtag pro. They are in energy production.
They work in energy production. Since Anino is out, we're just going to move to Rin. What division do they work in?
Human resources.
Everybody hates the HR guy.
Everybody, yeah.
That's funny.
Are you the HR guy?
No, I'm not.
How good or bad is the corp, Chris?
That's a good question. Let's see. I'm going to read through my options here for a second. How good or bad are they? And I just accidentally moved my scrolling wheel and jumped all over the place. I'm going to roll it.
Yeah.
It's more fun. Ruthless and profit-centered. Ooh. Willing to do some bad things.
Like a typical corp in the cyberpunk universe. Adelaide, where is that corp based?
This will be fun. We're gonna say they are statewide, small but sizable.
Okay. Deirdre, who's gunning for the group?
48. Okay, I just lost the page. Sorry. There we go. Who is gunning for the group? Thank you, Roll 20. And the answer is different divisions in your own company are feuding with each other. Take that rise up the corporate ladder real aggressively.
And Rin, you get the last question. How is their boss?
Boss is threatened by our meteoric rise and is planning to knife you.
I love how they present bosses in the exec thing. One of the other life path choice is boss is a psycho whose unpredictable outbursts are offset by quiet paranoia. Boss is a micromanager who tries to meddle in your work. This is so close to home, everyone.
It's so accurate.
So those were the life paths. We went through them twice. That's pretty cool. Like I said earlier, our characters tonight are not rolling their life paths because they've already done their background. They've already created their characters. What we're going to do now is we're going to go and check out the role abilities that they have. So we'll begin with Jinx. And we'll go around the table counterclockwise to Chris. So Jinx, as a nomad, your ability is called Moto, or Moto. I think it's Moto. Yeah, it's
probably Moto.
Like a motorcycle.
Mm-hmm.
Let me just find the page for it. There we go. So anytime you get a rank in your roll ability, so you're going to have four ranks to put in it, you can either choose a new vehicle to add to your motor pool of your family rank or lower, or you upgrade one with a single upgrade from the motor pool. So as a nomad, basically, Jinx can either have four vehicles with minimum specs, or two vehicles that are upgraded twice, or one vehicle that's upgraded three times, so long as the upgrade is within, or the vehicle is within, the ranks that you're allowed to take. So as a nomad, rank 1 to 4, you can choose between a road bike, a compact ground car, jet skis, or a gyrocopter. So we know that in the story, Jinx had a motorcycle, which is the road bike. So now you can either choose to have more, or you can upgrade your road bike if you wanted to. Now, the upgrades, not going to go through all of them, but a few of them are like a NOS, onboard flamethrower, armored chassis, bulletproof glass, seating upgrade, security upgrade. You can have a heavy weapon mount. You could have a combat plow. You could have an AV4 engine installed so that your land vehicle becomes an air vehicle. You can have deployable spike strip, enhanced interface plug integrations that allow you to dodge bullets with your car. So there's a bunch of upgrades that you can get for your character. Kusmoose, yeah, that's what we just did. Life path. It is still a thing. We did it right before break and after break. You can find that out on, if you want, on when we put VOD up on YouTube.
Yeah, but there's not one by decade like there is in Witcher.
Oh, it's not by decade. Yeah, no.
There's it's a little bit more generalized because yeah, you don't have as long a life.
Our next character would be Anino, with the charismatic impact of a rocker boy. Basically, what you can do with charismatic impact is you can have people... One, you can make someone into a fan of yours. Or you can ask your fans to do something for you. And the size of the group will affect the difficulty of the check. And your rank in ability will determine basically your audience and the places that you can play at. So right now, and I think that fits also the story, with a 4 in charismatic impact, Imanus can play in well-known clubs. Which I think Club Underground is becoming well known in Night City.
Yeah, okay.
And you can either convince a fan to do a major favor for you, convince a group of up to 6 fans to regularly hang out with you, provide booze, drugs, or other party favors, and people will buy your recordings and your merch. So at this point, you can be someone that lives off of what they do. No more fry cook at the Waffle House for you.
But I like Waffle House.
Well, I mean, you can if you want extra money, but you don't have to. So yeah, this is what charismatic impact does. When you get to higher, you play in larger venues like stadiums or even local video feed. You can convince your fans to go to war for you. You can ask them to cause, like, at first like minor crime, like mischief, but it goes to like major crime, like stealing or assault. You can have, you know, your whole fans go on a rampage for you, basically. And the higher it gets, the more favors you can have with your fans. Six fans at level four. It's not stated exactly how many, but they can convince a group of up to six fans to regularly hang out. So if you have more than that, you're going to have to exclude people. If you have less than that, then, I mean, hey, there's still room for more. Yes, favorite commissar, you could ask, at some point, you could ask your fans to murder someone for you. And someone would try to do it. That's how cult-like mentality can you could have as a rocker boy.
So, in just trying to, I'm trying to tie Jimenez's position in wrestling versus the charismatic impact. So, are we going to say that? Basically, in order for him to get to the next level, in which is basically Night City Wrestling, which is the main, like if we say Club Underground is sort of like the minor leagues,
yep,
where the development talent that eventually, if they prove themselves, would go on to move up to Night City Wrestling. So we would say that Night City Wrestling is somewhere, you know, in the 6 to 8 range.
I would put Night City Wrestling at 7.
Okay, so the reason why I was thinking that 6 to 8 is that I feel like the very very top, which would be Grand Prix Wrestling, would be 9 and 10.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, yeah, we can make it like that, so that Club Underground still has room to grow and reach rank 5. It would become a large, important club, and then you could slide into Night City Wrestling, which is still a large, important club, but it goes from large to, like, video feed and everything, because now it's not going to be necessarily fan cams and just, like, little venues and everything like you did in the first season.
Yeah. Okay. I think that's fair.
Cool. Converting someone to fandom. Yeah, I like that idea that, like, you show up and you just, through your own charisma, make people fan of yours. And that would have happened. Like, there's a few moments in the first season where that happened with Jimenez. And you got a bunch of new fans through it. Trins, as the tech, gets an ability called Maker, where the tech can fix, improve, modify, or invent new things. What Maker is, essentially, it's whenever you gain a rank in it, you have to put your point either in field expertise, which gives a boost to a whole lot of tech skills, basically any skill that has the word tech in it.
It's two. I get, once I get a point in Maker, I get 2 points to put, or I get 1 point to put in two of them. So I end up with 8 points to divide.
Oh yeah, you'll have, yeah, 8 points to divide. But I meant every point you put in field expertise gives you a +1 to all the tech-based thing. And that also gives you access to the jury rig thing. So jury rigging is now part of field expertise. Now you can also have upgrade expertise, which is another tree that will let you upgrade a piece of equipment if you succeed on a check. For example, it could increase the number of slots that an item has for options, lower the humanity loss of cyberware, so long as it's not Borgware, for example. Then you have fabrication and invention. Those two kind of go together. With invention, you invent something that doesn't exist in the book. So you talk with your GM, you decide, okay, look, I have this idea. I want to make a sound system that works as an alarm, a security measure throughout the building I live in. That is going to play Never Gonna Give You Up the moment someone enters the building unannounced or whatever. And what I'm just going off of both things that have happened in the game and just random bullshit.
I mean, now you know that's what's going to play. The alarm system's going to play that.
And then through invention, if the GM's okay with it, the GM will determine how expensive this invention is supposed to be. And that sets the DC for it. And then once you've invented it, you can use fabrication to take those blueprints and create the item that you've just invented. So four aspects for the maker, for the techie. Field expertise, which gives a boost to all of your tech skills. Upgrade, which is kind of cool. Also, field gives you access to jury rig. Then you have invention and you have fabrication. Let's move on to the solo in Reno.
Yes.
Reno's a bit complex because yours, you can change it every game.
I can use it anytime, essentially. I can change it pretty much anytime. Anytime I go into combat, anytime outside of combat or in combat with an action.
It's
pretty dope.
It's called combat awareness. It's for those of you who've played Cyberpunk 2020, almost the same thing, except that you have a lot more flexibility, I think, in this one than the previous one. So whenever you want, you take the ranks that you have in combat awareness and you put them either in a bonus to your awareness checks, bonus to your initiative, bonus to attacks. But it works with like 3, 6, 9 points. So it's not just a 1-for-1 in this case.
Mm-hmm.
+1 to damage. Damage deflection. So for 2, 4, 6, 8, 10 points,
mm-hmm.
you decrease, you gain like damage reduction. So for example, if it's for 2 points, it's the first point of damage you would take after armor. And then fumble recovery, which is for 4 points, so that's 4 points only, you ignore crit failures, so ones that you roll while attacking. So they still count as having rolled a 1, but they're not a fumble.
Right.
Anymore. And that, like you said, you can change them whenever you want. So you're going to have to probably print yourself this sheet and keep it
right. I'm going to tape it up to my monitor.
Yeah. What I would suggest is like write down the ones that are the like most common mm-hmm. that she's going to use.
The most likely ones,
Yeah. And then if something happens and we need to take the time to switch it, like we'll switch it mm-hmm. around.
Yep.
And then for our med tech. We've got medicine. And kind of like for Mr. White, kind of like with Trins, when you get ranks in medicine, you choose one of the 3 branches to put your point in, which can be surgery, which allows you to do surgery, which will be used to treat the more severe critical wounds, implant cyberware, and is only available to medtechs. So you cannot implant cyberware unless you have a medtech, either on your team or in your contacts, or you find someone to help. The second one is pharmaceutical, and the third one is cryosystem operation. I have to admit, I haven't read cryosystem operation just yet. I don't know, Chris, if you've taken the time to read about it.
I have.
What does it do?
So from what I've read so far, a cryosystem operation has to do with being able to run a cryosystem without a point in it. You well, struggle with that. So there are a couple pieces that you have to know how to use, the cryo pump and the cryo tank. And you also have to be able to afford them. They're luxury items. A character who's not a med tech cannot operate either of these items whatsoever. And with each level that you put into cryo system, you actually gain either access to pumps or tanks, or actually, like, you might own them. So it's, yeah, I mean, it can be pretty badass if you're gonna, you know, run that kind of a job. A cryo tank can hold a fully grown adult as long as the med tech knows what they're doing. And it keeps one person in stasis for as long as desired. They are considered unconscious, but they heal double the normal rate as long as they're in the tank. So think of it as a quick heal. Like, these are your healing potions. But
it's Luke Skywalker in the tank.
Yeah. So that's what you got there. The cryo pump is basically, it's a tool in order to keep everything running. And to put people in stasis. There we go. So yeah, it's pretty awesome. For that role, it is not something that Mr. White would ever choose to do, though, mm-hmm. for story reasons.
No, I feel like Mr. White would probably put his point in pharmaceuticals and surgery.
Yep.
Administering drugs and undergoing surgery.
Yep, he would not touch the cryo piece at all. So
that is a thing.
Sounds like my cleric that doesn't revivify. She doesn't.
Yeah.
I agree with this. Ask anyone in my games. In D&D, I only allowed revivify as a spell. Nothing else. Because I feel like a defibrillator could work, but nothing more.
Oh, she just doesn't do it for personal philosophy for personal reasons.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. That's even she won't, better.
She will now, since we've gotten to our, like, season two of our campaign. But season one, she wouldn't do it at all.
So what about our lawmen? So our lawmen's ability is called backup. They can call upon people for help. As they gain rank, they're promoted within their current law enforcement organization. Or they can be recruited in other law enforcement agencies that could that they could call backup from. So when in danger, you can call upon a bunch of people. In this instance, we're rank 4, so we can call upon local beat cops. It's 4 local cops on the beat. They arrive in 2 compact ground cars. They carry heavy pistols and are armored in Kevlar. Their combat number, which is used for both offense and defense, so think of it like their evasion and their handgun skills, if you will, would be a 10. So we're not gonna bother with, like, having a full skill sheet for those mooks. It's just, you need to shoot a d10 plus 10. You need to dodge a d10 plus 10. They have stopping power because of the Kevlar, so they have a 7. They have 25 hit points. Whereas if we were talking about a level 9 lawman, they can call upon C-SWAT. And it's 2 heavy hitters from the Psycho Squad. They carry assault rifles and rocket launchers. They're wearing metal gear. They arrive from the air in an AV-4. They've got plus 15 to all of their rolls, 18 stopping power, 35 hit points. So it's heavy hitting people. And then at level 10, you can just call, you know, Netwatch, Interpol, National Law Enforcement, the FBI. Those ones also will stick around after combat to help with cleaning up or investigation or stuff like that. So it's kind of cool to have like this team that you can call upon. Basically, when you call upon your backup, you roll a d6, and that's how many rounds you have to wait until they get on the roll, on the scene. If you roll a 6 on that roll, instead of your typical backup, the backup that arrives will be of the next highest level of backup. So, let's say you're a... Because you can call equal or lower than your backup rank. Yeah, so if you're rank 4 and you call local beat cups and you roll a 6, then they would still be beat cups. But if you were a 5, let's say, and you still called upon beat cups because they're one rank lower, then you would get them one rank higher. Jay, did I make a mistake in saying that? So like a full-on SWAT team at that point, or only a few dudes, the C-SWAT is 2 heavy hitters. So it's just 2 members of the Psycho Squad. And then at level 10, they travel in pair, so it's a pair of people. It's mostly, when you're low level, it's 4 really basic people with not a lot of equipment. And then as you boost your ranks, you get higher people in better gear with better stats, basically. If I look at the recovery zone marshal, for example, it's a single person with 50 health plus 16 to everything and a 15 stopping power. So, but yeah, you roll a d6 and it might take a while for them to arrive. So you have to make sure you're able to survive these, like, you know, 6 rounds at worst until they show up. But, you know, nothing prevents you from, I guess, calling them right before you strike. Yeah, the C-SWAT is the force that takes care of cyberpsychosis. And yeah, they show up with rocket launchers. So, could that ability possibly be reflavored for a gang member? I think so, favorite commissar. I mean, the way I see it, this is the type of ability that, you know, whenever you are in a leadership role and you have people at your beck and call that can be used for fighting, because the exec has the same thing. The exec has teamwork. And teamwork is basically a team of NPCs. They can be covered ups, bodyguards, netrunners, technicians, drivers. And with your ranks, you basically micromanage and build your team, give them stats and equipment and stuff like that, and have your like perfect team behind your character. If you were playing a netrunner, then you have access to the netrunner skills, which are the same skills that you saw in the jumpstart kit: scanner, backdoor, pathfinder, slide, zap, ID, control, virus, and cloak. If you were a what's the other one? The news person, the media has credibility, which can they can basically spread rumors, and they have access to sources to get information from. The fixer has abilities called operator, where they have both a certain reach, they have haggle abilities, and grease. From what I saw, the operator, the fixer, is the one that looks the most like a class from The Witcher, where you have like your main skill and then you would have like branches underneath. So whenever you you put points in it, your rank with like both reach, haggle, and grease increases, instead of having to put points in like a separate one by one. So, We've done that. We've done life paths. I think we should go shopping. Chat, are you ready to see a list of cyberware? And hear about all the cool toys you can get? Because that's what we're about to do. We're about to go shopping for cyberware and shove stuff inside our body. First of all,
question.
You should know. Yes.
Do we have to pay for the pieces that we already have?
So the only piece that you will not have to pay for is the eye and Chiron, which I gave everyone. Arasaka gave everyone.
So the radio jink, the radio jack and the eye, right?
Well, the radio jack is called Chiron.
Okay, just I'm sorry.
Yeah. So the eye and Chiron, those are free for all of you.
Cool.
When you create a character in Cyberpunk Red, you begin with $2,550 to buy any cyberware, weapons, armor, gear, etc. And you also start with $800 purely for fashion wear and just fashion in general. However, pieces of equipment, cyberware, comes with a humanity loss. You have a humanity score equal to 10 times your empathy. That's very important.
What is it? What times?
10 times your empathy.
10 times, okay.
Yeah. So if your empathy is a 5, you've got 50. Now, every time you add a piece of cybertech to your body, your humanity is going to go down. If your humanity goes down by an entire first digit, like by an entire 10, so if you go from 50 to 48, for example, well, then your empathy would go down from a 5 to a 4. Which is why it's very interesting for Reno, because it means that the lower your empathy is, the more at risk for cyberpsychosis you become.
Mm-hmm.
So with the amount of cybertech that she had in her, she was probably someone who was on the at-risk list in IEC. So if you look at the cyberware, which begins on page 82 of our document, you'll notice that there is a number for HL. HL is humanity loss. So we don't need the number in parentheses. That's if you get it installed over the course of the game. If you get it installed during character creation, you use the first number. Is that good for everyone?
Okay, so just making understand, since that. we're all going to lose at least one point of humanity in creation.
There's a big chance that yes, because the Cyber Eye and Chiron together are worth 9 points.
Okay, but what I'm saying is, like, if for example, our humanity level is at 50, you're saying if we go from 50 to 49, that means that we've lost a point of humanity.
Yeah.
Empathy. Okay.
Okay, so we all got a Cyber Eye. And there are options for the cyber eyes on here. Are we just free to pick at will for which one we upgraded, or do we all have the same one, or what's up?
By default, you all have Chiron because this was given during the game.
Chiron. Oh, that's right. Chiron. Okay.
Yeah. Chiron, by the way, projects a tiny subscreen into the user's normal field of vision for messages, videos from other people, and a picture in a picture for real life. So it's like the Google Glass. Prof. Richter, if you want to know, the first number is the average humanity loss that you would get from taking. So, for example, a lot of the fashion wear at character creation costs 2. If you check, like, the other number is a D6 divided by 2. So a D3, basically.
So what's the humanity hit for the Cyber Eye and the Chiron?
9
The Cyber Eye is Chiron.
No, the Cyber Eye is a Cyber Eye. And inside the Cyber High, yeah, the Chiron.
Oof, that's high. That's high, baby.
And then the audio, that Cyber audio itself is also another, isn't that also another 7+?
The Cyber audio?
Yeah, the radio.
Yeah. The radio. Your radio. That's what I'm saying. It's like,
okay, in my mind, the radio was all done through text. You mutter it under your breath, and it sends it as text to the others.
Gotcha. So that it's not two separate pieces. It's all one unit.
It's all one thing. Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay. So it's basically talk to text.
Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, that sucks. Okay, so I had the low light from season one, and I need to, it requires two option slots and it must be paired, which means I have to also install another cyber eye. Is it 7 total for both eyes, or is it 7 for each eye?
Each eye.
Oh.
Yeah, purchase twice.
Oh, that's a lot. Okay, that kind of sucks.
So yeah, that's the total of 19 for the Chiron and low light.
Yeah. Well, no. I don't have to do 14. Wait.
Yeah, okay. You just have to add. It's the total of 14
I'm really bad
plus
at math.
2.
14 plus 2.
You're at 16.
Yeah, 16.
Because it's
plus low light is 3.
Oh, 3 light. Yeah, low light is 3. That's yeah.
Right. So it's plus. It's 14 plus 5. It's 7.
Yeah.
For one eye, 7 yeah. for the other, 2 for yeah. Chiron. 3 for low light.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, no, it's more than that because it requires 2 option slots.
No, that doesn't mean you have to buy it twice. Basically what it says is low light, you have to have both eyes to have low light. Yep. But you don't have to buy low light twice.
Well, actually no, I don't think that's true. It says some options must be paired in order to work properly. And in parentheses, purchased twice and installed in 2 different cyber eyes on a user.
So that'd be 22 points.
Yeah.
Hey, wow. Jay, tell us which one it is.
Yeah, so we have a question for Jay in chat. Cyber eyes. So basically, if I want low light, does it cost me 20? Or does it cost me 10? Or does it cost me 16?
Jay is checking. Thank you, Jay. We appreciate you and all your hard work.
I'm assuming I had heard that they had changed where limbs do not cost you any HL points.
If it's a replacement, so from what I understand, if you are replacing a lost or a, a quote unquote defective part, like if you were naturally like nearsighted or something like that, right. I feel like getting cyber eyes wouldn't cause you humanity loss because you're trying to improve upon.
Yeah, it's not disability. Like you're doing this for the fun of it.
Wait, this doesn't.
I'm trying to find.
It doesn't actually. This doesn't make much. I'm confused by the. Okay, so cyber arms say, blah blah blah. Each comes pre-installed with a standard hand that doesn't cost any humanity loss or take up a cyber arm option slot. That makes sense. But then on the cyber arm, it says HL is 7, and in the standard hand, HL is 2. So it does cost humanity loss.
Looking at this here. Yeah, but... Right, okay, so if I just look at this table right now, a cyber arm with a hand would cost you 7 humanity instead of 9.
Because you can do the hand separate from the arm.
Because you can get a hand separate from the arm.
That's true. That's... I don't like that.
So we're still saying that the pair of cyber eyes is... 7 humanity loss, or is it?
I think
14.
I think Jay is checking on it.
Yeah.
Jay said he was checking. You pay twice for any option you install.
Oh, so 7 for the eyes. But then.
But you're paying.
But you're paying twice.
You're paying, Yeah, you're not paying twice the humanity loss. You're paying twice for the
money.
Money.
Ah, okay. Yeah, that makes a whole lot of sense now. So okay. To go back on our eye with Chiron, that still is a 9 humanity, but Adelaide.
Uh-huh.
Your eyes.
Okay.
Only cost you 12 humanity.
Okay. Okay.
It's just that so basically if you have one eye, your humanity loss is already there.
Okay.
So it might as well just do the other.
Right. Okay. That makes sense. Okay.
It's just money-wise, it's going to cost you. So like low light, since it needs to be in both eyes instead of 500,
mm-hmm.
it's 1,000.
Yeah. Oh, still though.
There will be various options for replacing lost body parts as opposed to enhancing them. Anything you do like this is enhancement. So, I'm going to ask you a question, Adelaide. Did Reno ever lose a limb? Or was
it wasn't a hey, I'll just cut my arm off. it was definitely, I haven't written out like the details of it, but she had lost it like while she was working for IEC. IEC didn't like cut her arm off.
Okay. And then insurance policy was like, well, lost your arm in the.
Right. We'll give
in
you
the course arm. Of a job. So we'll give you another one.
Right.
So what we'll do is for that cyber arm.
Uh-huh.
We won't put any humanity loss on it.
Okay.
But any options you put in it, though, comes with humanity loss.
Right. That makes sense. Okay. There's so many options. Oh
also, remember that you stole a shit ton of cybertech from IEC. So if you have a list of cybertech that you're like, I would like to have that, but I might not have the money for it. We'll check off camera, but like, yeah, you might be able to deck yourselves out a little bit.
We might have it, and we can install it.
Yeah, that's it. There will be, I believe, medical grade stuff that doesn't offer any benefit. Like, not even your arm is a melee weapon. Yeah, okay, that makes sense.
Okay. So... then it's just fashion wear.
Okay, and we had the cyber eye from Chiron, with Chiron. We had the radio communicator.
Which is called Chiron.
That's also called Chiron?
Simon said that we got that all, it's all part of the cyber eye. It's basically talk to text.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, right, so it's not two separate
jaw,
ones.
Not the jaw thing.
Well, that's where it is. That's where it's located, but it's not a separate piece.
It's all the same. Like, for the purposes
my
of...
My brain it's an is extension. Trying to...
it's okay. An extension.
Yes. Okay. I'm math woman right now. Yeah.
Think of it like an antenna.
Gotcha. Okay, that makes sense.
So, for people who might want to know about, like, a few of the things, in fashion wear, you have light tattoos, you have bio monitors, you have chem skin, where your skin is... you change the pigmentation of your skin. In neural wear, you have chipware sockets, interface plugs. You have the, for example, the tactile boost that boosts your sense of touch, allowing you to detect motion within 20 meters as long as their hand is touching a surface. It's like a motion detector with your hands. You have pain editors. You have skill chips. Skill chips are back. Memory chips are back as well. In the cyber eyes, yeah, Chiron, like we said, the text-to-speech thing. You can have a dart gun installed in your eye. You can have an image enhancer. You can have a virtual projector so that you can have brain dance on the go. You can have a radiation detector, so like a Geiger counter inside your eye. In cyber audio, you have radio communicator, you have voice stress analyzer to try to find when people are lying at you and stuff like that. Audio Vox, which is a vocal synthesizer. You can have gills, grafted muscle. Of course, the Mr. Stud sexual implant is back. And so is the Midnight Lady. You can have...
I love the description on that, by the way. It's hilarious.
Great. Yeah. Every time I read it, I have the song from the commercial. There's one that I like a lot called the Cyber Snake, which is a throat esophagus mounted tentacle weapon. So make of that what you will.
But it's kind of on brand for you.
It's pretty on brand. Like, I'm not saying that if it existed for real, I would install a tentacle weapon inside my throat. But I'm just saying there's a lot of applications to having a tentacle come out of your esophagus.
I mean, people would pay a lot of money for that now, so.
There's a market for it.
I've seen shit on the internet.
Yeah. It's a kink somewhere.
I think, Old School Empire, I think there are some new pieces and a lot of it's a carryover. There's some new ones, some old ones.
Yeah.
Like,
of course, the Mantis Blades aren't in there, because Mantis Blades won't appear before 2077.
Yeah, because, you know, we killed Mulhound. He has a problem.
He had a experimental Mantis Blade. But yeah, so there's a ton of cyber implants. Fenthissa in chat, you asked, what kind of cyber tech does a Netrunner need? To be fair, I wouldn't know at the moment, given that there's an enormous list of cyberware and that I don't have the full rules for net running. So I wouldn't know exactly. Like, I know you can have your interface plugs and you can have a cyber deck inside your arm. Is it inside your arm?
At minimum, they'll need a neural link with an interface plug. So that's a minimum of 10, or not 10, sorry, 14.
Yeah.
Just to be able to connect to a cyber deck.
Yeah.
And that's just what Jay said. So.
Red is largely compatible with 2020. It's to a point. Like, I mean, for the campaign we've been running, I've been using a lot of 2020. You have to do a bit of conversion when it comes to damage from weapons and stuff like that. Yeah, it's feasible to have both running. There's a bit of conversion to do, but it's feasible. Yeah, Shinobi, Mantis Blades aren't, they don't appear before the video game. So, but right now you can have the Wolvers, which is basically a pair of Wolverine claws. Which is always fun to have. And as a short Canadian, I feel like I should have Wolvers. Adelaide is laughing at
only
something.
Oh, I'm laughing at you. Only if you shave the beard the same way, you know? You gotta get the
yeah,
chops.
I would have to leave the mutton yeah. chops. Yeah.
Yeah, Rin says no. No.
Nope.
No one wants me to do funny things with my facial hair.
Hair grows back. It grows back.
Yeah, I get voted out on that all the time too by my significant other. She just looks at me and goes, "Uh-uh, I'm not going out in public with you."
Do wolvers work with martial arts? Wolvers are melee weapons. They're not martial arts. They use melee weapons.
Wow, a subdermal pocket. Now you'd never have to worry about wearing girls' pants and not being able to carry things.
Yeah, with a real skin zipper. I don't like the image of, like, zipper skin.
I mean, I carry lots of things in my boobs, you know? That's why they're so big.
The problem is, it's only a 2x4. Like,
I know, I'm leaving.
Well, I mean, I have a measuring tape right here. Let me just check 2x4. Two?
Yeah.
By four? It's very tiny.
Adelaide.
Yes.
See, here's the thing. I think if we were going to go that way, you should go full on and understand that that would only be an A cup.
Well, yeah, but that's if they're going to stick to traditional gendered clothing, you know? Like, are they going to restrict me to a small subdermal pocket because I'm a woman? Is that it?
Well, I'm just saying the subdermal pocket is only a 2x4.
Some of them are actually just incisions, and they're not even pockets. They're just, it's fake. It's just a line on your skin.
Oh, God, that just pissed me off even more.
They look like pockets, but they're not.
Just like the jeans that have the patches put on that are supposed to be back pockets, but they really are just patches that are sewn on.
I mean, this is a thing. I think
you could put it like on your neck and then you unzip it and then the tentacles come out, you know?
I mean, the way I figure the tentacles work is you have to, like, move your head backwards like this. And it comes out, but your head is still, like, you're always facing the ceiling.
You muted yourself, Adelaide.
Of course, because they don't have any room to move around otherwise. But yeah, you know, you can just put a zipper over it. It's like, surprise, motherfucker.
So basically, you know, a facehugger. Good to know. But I do want to say that one of the things that I like is that Trin's, his hair is now canon. That you can actually have the tech hair.
You can have tech hair and hair that changes color. Yeah. Remember, everyone, not to necessarily burn your 2,500 on cyberware alone.
But it's fun.
Because right under you have the weapons and armor to get.
Okay, but wait, we got armor.
Yeah, what I'm going to ask you is the armor you got in game, but the weapons that you had on your sheet originally, we're going to see if you're allowed to, like, if you can purchase it.
I need to purchase my comically large wrench, which is my prized possession.
Yeah, it's $50.
Okay.
It counts as a baseball bat.
Okay, an aluminum baseball bat I'll give you.
Well, otherwise...
It's not a sledgehammer?
I mean, if you want it to be that comically large, yes.
I mean, I was thinking, like, because the art is, like, 2.5-3 feet tall in that art. You can see it in the picture. So it's either like this, maybe like the spiked bat or the sledgehammer.
I would go, let's go for heavy melee weapon.
Okay.
Because I feel like very heavy melee weapons are also less wieldy.
Okay. It's like, and the question is this concealable? No, it is a comically large wrench. It is never supposed to be concealed.
I mean, you could just get like a giant leg skin pocket, you know?
I figure if you buy, like, if you buy multiple skin pockets, you can have them together and just increase the area.
Right.
So yes, if you want to have like a zipper that goes like from the top of your neck to like just above your butt.
Okay, the meat suit thing is creepy.
Yes.
That is super gross.
I mean, it is very gross. Even just the 2x4 bucket, I find it gross.
Yeah, it's so weird. That's such a weird addition. I can see why it's added, but like,
yeah.
God, it brings a whole new meaning to like the sweaty dollar bills.
By the way, for those that are wondering, Netrunners can also have a cyber deck implanted into an arm, a cyber arm. That way they cannot lose it. Integration into a cyber arm gives any cyber deck one extra slot that can be used for either programs or hardware. So it's like an upgraded cyber deck that you can have. What?
Oh, sorry. I didn't realize my microphone was still on. I'm just laughing at Chris being extremely disappointed with me right now.
Why? What have I said? What have I done?
No, I said Chris is disappointed with me right now.
Oh, I heard Chris is disappointed in you, and I'm like, no, I didn't say cyber dick. I said cyber deck.
No. Wait, I'm disappointed in someone?
Oh, no, just with my series of disgusting jokes.
Oh, no, not at all.
No. I know you're not disappointed.
I'm actually just looking at all of the different stuff and kind of lost in the...
Yeah,
vast charts. Yeah.
While everyone is shopping, chat, do you have any questions about character creation? Is there anything that you that you're wondering about? Things that we haven't touched tonight?
Okay. So I think I've fixed things out. I moved some things around. So she ends up where she's supposed to be.
Eraser, the 800 that we mentioned was for fashion wear and fashion. So yeah, think of it like clothes, like the stuff that you would wear or like the tattoos or the piercings that you would have. Purchase restrictions beyond price? Not from what I saw. Some of them are written as premium, expensive, very expensive. If I look at the weapons,
some
of it has to do with availability, and some of it has to do with the more expensive things and more complex things about where you get them done.
Yeah, because otherwise, there doesn't seem to be any indication that something is impossible to get. Like, I mean, if you have the money to burn on a Rheinmetall EMG-86 railgun, then frickin' go ahead. Or Malorian Arms 3516, which is a excellent quality, exotic, very heavy pistol that does 5d6 with a single shot. That's 10,000 bucks, for example. So, like, of course, if you have the wealth for it, like you can purchase it. And there's also a chart with like the master gear list, which gives you a lot of choices of things that you can purchase for your character. Is nude a fashion style? I don't think so.
Not with that attitude.
Some new programs. Crytex, I do not know if there are new programs. The Netrunner has a list of skills, but I haven't... Oh, Master Netrunning List. Okay, let's see. Programs. We have the Worm, the Sia... I mean, Speedy Gonzalez was already there, I remember, from the Jumpstart kit anyway. Eraser, Banhammer, Sword, Deck Rash. There's the Bolt, the Super Glue. And there's Black Ice. So, there's more than just the Hellhounds. Now you have a few fun ones, such as the dragon that deals 6d6 damage to a program. If this damage would be enough to derez the program, it is instead destroyed. Which, compared to the Hellhound, it seems that the dragon is a very, very big countermeasure. You can also customize your cyber deck with hardened circuitry, DNA lock, crash barrier, backup drives. So there's a few options for that. Oops, sorry, as well. I've got the hiccups. How do the new pop-up night markets play into getting equipment? I am not sure. That part we don't have right now in the document. But I figure these would be night markets that would appear. And you would, like, some of them would have access to, let's say, expensive items and lower. Or only cheap items or something like that. Are the amounts given flat across the board, or do they vary depending on role? No, it's flat across the board for everyone. 2,550. That's everyone gets the same amount. Is there a different style of martial arts? Yes. Right now, what were the styles, Anino?
There are rules for karate, judo, aikido, and
taekwondo.
I think that's it. And taekwondo.
And taekwondo. And they are more expensive than brawling. They cost 2 points per instead of one for one. Ammunition management. That's a good question. I've seen ammo. And your pistols need to be reloaded. But they're not in... Oh, ammunition.
Yeah, there's ammunition.
Yeah, yeah. I was going to say they're not in the weapons. No, they're right after. And you have different types of ammunition. So there's still some ammo management that you need to do. This was like, well, sorry, Aftershock. We're going to... if we're going too fast, we are nearing the normal end of our stream, but we might do another tiny part. So is Reno going to have the most humanity loss?
I believe so. I'm not taking a lot. I have my big Nox, which would be humanity loss, my low light cyber eyes, and the Chiron cyber eye. And I believe that's all I'm taking. I thought about more. But that's what I started out with originally. I didn't have any more than that. Maybe another cyber limb attachment.
Hmm.
But I'm not sure yet. But yeah, probably I have the highest, yeah. It's at 15 now, currently.
Okay.
So maybe 18 total.
Do you buy programs during character creation? Seems like it, yes. The way it's laid out in the books, it seems like you are buying programs during character creation. Is there an equivalent to a family special ability? No, it is only Modo. And anything family specific would be handled through background and roleplay, I guess. So being a high-end corpo doesn't affect anything. Well, it should be noted that the corp and the nomad, like Jay said, start with some gear. The nomad does begin with their motorcycle or their vehicle. And the exec begins with given their stuff. Let me just go back into the skills. corporate con ops. Yeah, they can. They have like an apartment. They have clothing for free that is given to them. So to start the game with. And then they get their team members. What quantity is ammo sold in? Let me check.
10.
It's by pack of 10?
Yeah, I think I remember that from the first time. I don't think they would change that.
Yeah, grenades and rockets are purchased individually. All other ammunition is purchased in increments of 10. What are the perks of using martial arts over brawling? Martial arts do give you access to special moves. Brawling is more for grappling and just, you know, if you don't really know how to stand your own in a fight, from what I understood.
Also, two attacks a round for martial arts. Rate of fire, too.
And you can deal damage to armor as opposed to not with grappling.
Yeah, I may have to change to martial arts.
Well, you have big knucks already, right? So.
Well, yeah, but I mean, like, thematically, she's not, you know, not just like a, I learned to fight on the streets. Like, she's not, like, professionally trained, like, as in what Anino does, but she knows what she's doing, I guess, if that makes sense.
But in your case, mercenary. Your big knucks, yeah, your big knucks also go through armor.
That's true.
Could one write their own program? Well, I guess favorite commissar. Like, if we want to stick to the rules, I'd say a techie could probably use invention to invent a new program for the Netrunner. That would be possible, I guess. Or, you know, depending on how your game works, maybe your GM will let you, as a Netrunner, just create, like, invent new programs. I mean, you could be like a programmer and just create your programs yourself. And I see the techie more as a hardware engineer than anything. Yeah, Richter, right now, in the document that we have, I think we do not have net running creation. Those are black ice. Yeah, no, there's no... there's no creation of programs for the moment.
Yeah, it looks like that's all going to be stored in the netrunning section of chapter, the core book. Yeah. Yep.
Jimenez. Well, and you know, Fantissa is asking, are any of the martial arts fit for you?
I'm going to say that I'm going to use the judo as my martial art. So I wanted to take advantage of the special moves that go with it. There are two that go along with judo. One is a grab escape. And so if you're grappled and you make two successful melee attacks against the person who's grappling you, you get to break out of that grapple without losing an action. And your opponent needs to roll versus a DV of 15. And if they fail, you break their arm. So I thought that was a pretty cool move. And then the other one, cool move, is a counter throw, in which if you dodge successfully all the melee attacks that target you while you're being grappled, you can immediately throw someone and they can't roll to resist. So it's a automatically successful throw. So I think I'm going to basically call his move, his style is more of a street brawling wrestling kind of thing, maybe a sort of jiu-jitsu kind of thing, mixed martial arts. But yeah, those are the two moves I'm going to go with. Because judo kind of limits him in the fact that judo doesn't have any actual striking techniques in it. And I think we've decided that Menez does know how to throw a pretty good punch or drop kick. So go with that.
Weight class is Menez? Is he a middle? He looks like a middleweight.
No, his he's about 6'2", 230.
I don't know what that means.
That's heavyweight.
Okay, thank you. Smile and nod.
He's tall and fit.
Big boy.
Yeah.
Yeah, middleweight is 154 to 160 pounds.
Oh shit, I'm middleweight.
For the record, I fought in the light heavyweight divisions.
Is a smaller body going to have any advantages over larger bodies? Yagos, I'm not quite sure what your question is. Are you talking about, like, mechanically speaking?
Yeah, I mean, right now, mechanically speaking, body is almost better because it gives you more hit points.
Yeah. The more body you have, the better it is. Can you use improvised weapons like iron pipes? Yes, they count as melee weapons. You just pick it up and you whack someone across the face with it. Providing that you have skills in melee weapons, for example. 2020 had rules for inventing a new skill. Are there any indications that there will be rules for that in Red? I don't know. Right now we have 62 skills, so that's a whole lot. But I guess if something doesn't fit in one of the 62 skills that already exist, you can probably just like tweak it or find something for that. Cast, I have a question for you. Are you okay to keep going for a few minutes?
Sure.
Yeah, of course.
All right.
Oh, shit, it's 11, huh?
It's already 11. We're just going to take another quick bio break. We'll be back in about 5 minutes, and we'll go through another round of questions from you all. So be right back. Hello, we are back. To answer your question, Albiro Alpha, this intro was made by Displacer Rat in chat right now, or a Three-Eyed Rat on Twitter. He's a friend of mine. He built this intro for the specifically for the show. The music that was taken for the intro was taken from Sirenscape, from their official Sirenscape sound set for Tales from the Forlorn Hope for Cyberpunk Red. And yeah, and the rest is taken from a pack of resources for overlays. So like the red things you see around us and all that, that keep moving. This is basically just a movie file that just plays. Hello, Jess. It's Hi, Jess. Making characters. So have me once a week. Yeah, hello people that are coming in late. This is now past 11, so this is Wandering DM After Dark.
Oh. Here we go.
I'm kidding, I'm not doing that tonight.
No, that's Thursday.
I was getting ready.
We could, but we're talking about character creation with Cyberpunk. So let's go around the table. Tell us for fun, what did you purchase for your character? What kind of cyberware did you deck yourself out with?
And we also want to make a clarification, right? About that humanity loss thing.
Oh, yeah. So humanity loss and empathy is different than what we said earlier. I said the moment that you're... empathy went down, let's say, from 50 to 49, you lost the point of empathy, but that's not true. It's whenever you go down by 10, so a complete 10 points of empathy, that you lose a point. 10 points of humanity that you lose a point of empathy. So, let's see. How would one go about acquiring a custom-made sniper rifle or weapon in general? Find someone that will sell it to you.
I know a guy.
Yeah, or in the rules, just purchase them.
Or you do a really nice favor for the guys from Arasaka, and then they give you the stuff.
Yeah, they give you stuff, and then you hope against hope that they will not come to collect at some point.
What are they going to collect? The stuff was a thank you for not killing him.
Preventing him from being killed by somebody else.
Corps always come up with an excuse.
Tomato, tomato. I also, free of charge, made sure that his family's cemetery plots were not plundered.
Mm-hmm.
If he comes back and asks for anything...
Oh, it might not be him.
Oh, yeah.
We'll I'll shoot him.
So, let's start with Chris. What did you get?
I honestly didn't get anything beyond what we already talked about. There's not a whole lot there. There might be, I'm debating, I might add the toxin binders and take that. I haven't quite made that decision yet, but I'm leaning toward that one, which will, it just seems like it'd be good for his line of work. I also thought a little bit about the enhanced antibodies as well. But that's about as far as I've gotten. I take that back. And then the other thing that he was thinking about was different armor. And I haven't quite made the decision yet, but I've got on my wish list actually a bodyweight suit, which is typically Netrunner gear. But he has reasons.
What about Reno?
Yeah, so I got my same stuff that I started out with in the other game. So I have the Chiron Cyber Eye, I have the Low Light Cyber Eye, I have my Big Nux. And as far as weapons go, I've got a baseball bat, a combat knife, my heavy pistol, my assault rifle, an agent. Low priority food for me, although I think she's going to upgrade since she's feeling like she's living the high life. But of course, only the best for my cat, Dutch.
So you're going to eat kibbles, but not your cat?
Yeah, no. Yeah. Never.
Yeah.
Cat's going to live forever.
What about Trins?
Trins, for cybertech, cyberware, well, she had the Chiron system that everybody has, and she has her rippers, because, you know, those are useful. But it's also Trins. How could I not go with the tech hair that lights up multiple colors? And she has a light light tattoo somewhere.
Somewhere. Ooh.
She is not a tramp stamp girl, though. Let's put that out there right away.
What about Jimenez?
So, Jimenez doesn't really have a whole lot to spend on because if he's fighting, it's because he failed in talking his way out of things, but you know, just as a backup, because going in just dressed as a mime to our climactic battle was not very useful. So we're going to say that you know, he'll carry a sword and a heavy pistol with him when he's going in to fight like that. But as far as cyberware goes, it's just the Cyber Eye and the Chiron that he got from Arasaka. Canonically, I want to say that extensive cyberware is frowned upon in professional wrestling due to just the nature of professional wrestling and the risk of cyber psychosis and, you know, people snapping in the middle of the ring in front of people is just not very great publicity, so he's fairly simple. He'll probably spend the rest of his money on plumbing tools, because I have retroactively decided that he does have a plumber's license as his backup profession, which will come in handy now for the being an owner of a part owner of
this. You're a thinker, Nino.
Wait, is he quitting Waffle House?
Yeah. He actually quit Waffle House already. It's just that, you know, now something goes wrong. No.
I just assumed he would go back and ask for his job back.
No, it's because he actually got or arranged for an additional job at the Club Underground, doing the booking, so he actually gets cut of the gate now. Pretty cool. But yeah, so he'll probably spend the rest of his money on just things to help him live comfortably enough that he isn't putting himself under undue stress for his job as a professional wrestler. So he'll get good food and great coffee thanks to Found Familiar. And, you know.
And we have our plug for tonight.
And he's going to have to buy nice clothes, because apparently that's a skill now.
And I have a question for Jimenez, now that we also discovered you're a plumber and a wrestler. Would you be against wrestling a person dressed as a dragon while you're wearing overalls and a fake mustache?
Would he cosplay as Mario, essentially? Is that what you're asking?
Could we reenact Super Smash Brother?
He might. He You might do it for like one of those kid friendly shows.
A Mario poser gang. Oh, there's definitely that somewhere in the world. And what about Jinx? What did Jinx get?
All right. Well, I have the Chiron. I had the targeting scope in the eye. Because I have my sniper rifle with the smart gun link. But that's going to take more stuff like the neural link. I'll have to check that with you later. Otherwise, she has a light tattoo also. I love tattoos. And she has some stuff to like live comfortably and stuff. And yeah, for now that's about it. Because if I bought everything I wanted, I'd have like zero empathy left. So I might have to rethink my stuff a little bit. But there's like a lot of choices that are really interesting. So we'll see.
And everyone can hear my cat.
Not gonna lie, I looked up to see if it was my cat that was looking for attention.
No, it's normally streams over at this time, so it's time for them to come bug us. There we go, we have one.
Father, I am starving. My bowl is only 3/4 full.
Yep. That said, do y'all have other questions, players or people among chat? We'll take a couple minutes to answer anything else that you might have, but otherwise, that is pretty much our unveiling of the character generation rules for Cyberpunk Red. Hope you've enjoyed it. Hope you you learned some cool things, and hope it made you want to get the book even more so now that you have gotten a sneak peek, a taste of what Cyberpunk Red will bring. Is there anything on how auto fire works? Hey, good question. There is a skill
to keep it steady, yeah.
But as far as, like, I figure that would be in the combat section, how auto fire actually works. What I would do if I were you, Kampaku-san, is I would take the rules for auto fire from the jumpstart kit. And so there's a difficulty, a DV that you need to hit. And for every point above that, you roll one extra damage roll to a maximum of 3. But instead of using... So for the rules, instead of using your marksmanship ability or like whatever pistol or like handgun or rifle or whatever skill you're using, you would actually use the skill called auto fire. And a weapon that is capable of auto firing. One last question that is a bit off topic for weaponry. What is something that you find really damn cool, stats and all? Ooh. I like the wolvers. I like the tentacle thing. But I do like... Where is it? The battle gloves.
Yeah, I was looking at those. I don't know what they do. I don't understand it yet, but it sounded cool.
So the battle gloves is a heavy gauntlet covering the hand and the forearm. It contains 3 option slots for cyber arm or cyber limb. When worn, the options stored in the gloves can be accessed. Basically, you put them on and they're like mini cyber arms that you can have without losing access to this... to the humanity that would come with having them built in you. as a cyber arm. And I've always kind of liked Jax from Mortal Kombat. So I like the idea of having these big titanic gauntlets and just like going to town on someone with that. Reno had a super special arm in the intro and got a throwaway one at the end. Is she upgrading it?
We upgraded at the end of season one. It wasn't a throwaway kind of arm. Like, it wasn't a janky arm. It wasn't as, like, pristine metal, whatever IEC gave her. But it just wasn't the fancy colors that she likes. She likes black and gold. So at the end, she repainted her thingy. Got the nicer gold tipped big knucks.
Would the battle gloves work with martial arts abilities? Probably, depending on what you put in them. Because if you put like claws in them, well, then they become melee weapons, so they stop functioning with martial arts. There is a 2-part game session where Mike Pondsmith is the game master. Yeah. Yeah, you can check it out. It was, oh my god, I don't remember the channel. Let me check it's... very quickly. It's Realm something.
It's not Realms Remembered. It's Realm Smith. Thanks, UKJ.
Realm Smith. Yeah. And, I can copy video URL. Here's a link to the, first video of the 2-part. They've put it on YouTube. It's also, if you go on the Arthalsorian website in their latest updates for Cyberpunk, you'll also find a link there for the video.
Yeah, for part one and part two, and yeah, rumor of a part three.
So, that's going to be it for us. Hope everyone had fun. Thank you, all of you, for joining. Thank you to all of you players for coming back after Season 1. We will take a very short break before Season 2, just so I, you know, prep things up for our second season. So we'll be back very, very soon. If you follow me on Twitter, @wandering_DM, I will post when we're coming back. It'll probably most likely be in 2 weeks or something like that. So it's not going to be a big break, but for sure we are not having a game next week. But yeah, follow me on Twitter. I'll post when we're going live again for the next game. I have a bunch of things to plug, but before I do that, let's go around the table. Tell us where we can find you on the internet. What do you have going on in your lives aside from this here game? And we'll start with Rin. We'll go counterclockwise.
Hey, I'm Rin. Okay, get off. Basically, you can find me here for Cyberpunk, and on Thursdays, we're going to have an anime game. So you'll be able to find me there. Otherwise, I'm at Heaven's Night on Twitch, or Burns Through the Rain in Twitch chat. And that's about it for now. Yep.
Anino.
How's it going, everyone? My name's Anino. You can find me on Twitter at Anino Gaming. This weekend, you will find me on the Other Doc channel for my other two weekly TTRPG games. Saturday nights at 8 p.m. Eastern is Invisible Sun, and on Sunday evenings at 7 p.m. Eastern time is Dark Matter Campaign. So definitely tune in for that. Not really sure what else is going on next week, but just follow me on Twitter, and I'll keep you guys posted on my shenanigans as well.
Deirdre.
Oh, hey, y'all. You know me. I'm at Deirdre Donlin on Twitter, Praxagorathesmiaphoria, as you see me out and around on Twitch. And tomorrow I will be back here as I get to do the GM funness for a new campaign of Magpie Games Rapscallion. We're calling Black Sail. We did the session Black Flag. There we go. Black Sails is a wonderful Showtime series that is in no way affiliated with this game whatsoever. I may have spent a lot of time watching last night. But the series of the game is called Black Flag. And the if Session Zero, we did character creation. That's up on Simon's YouTube channel. And if you follow the Roll20 app on Twitter, apparently they did a very nice write-up about us for that. It was posted today. And we'll see what shenanigans happen tomorrow, 1 o'clock. I'll be here. You should come join us.
Adelaide.
Yeah, I'm OAdelaide on Twitter, Adelaide Gardner. I am in a variety of shows throughout the week, including this one. Actually, I'm only in two shows in the week, and then I have my podcast, Fae Forge Academy, that records on Sundays and releases on Fridays. I am also 1/4 of a tabletop company called Action Fiction. We just released our first game, Monsters of Murka, as well as, for any Tiger King fans out there, we just released an expansion that's all Tiger King related. So that's fun. That's on DriveThruRPG. If you like parody games, this is an American political and cultural satire game for 5e. It's a lot of fun, so go check that out. Action Fiction, Monsters of Murka is the name of the game.
And Chris.
Hey everyone, I'm Chris Geary. You can find me on Twitter at Chris Geary. I keep it kind of the same. The only things going on for me right now is Fridays. We have Cyberpunk, and that'll be on hiatus for a little while. And yeah, I'm working with a very talented team on a tabletop RPG called Omens Rising, and there'll be more details as we progress. But if you are ever interested in learning more and doing some playtests on a system that is different than most others, feel free to find me on Twitter, and we'll see what we can work out.
And there is now a pupper where Adelaide used to be.
Yeah, that's Kingston.
Hi, Kingston.
He's trying not to fall asleep.
Oh. Now we all look at the pupper. That's how the stream ends. No, but I'm Simon at Wandering DM. Wandering underscore DM on Twitter. If you heard Deirdre earlier, tomorrow we are having our first session of Rapscallion, well, Black Flag, a Rapscallion campaign. Then on Monday, we're coming back with Legacy, Life Among the Ruins. We, due to some bad news IRL, had to postpone for a few weeks, but we'll be back on Monday. And then on Tuesday, we're back for The Witcher. And on Thursday for the last episode of our Thirsty Thursdays with Dragon Age. And then starting next week on Thursdays, we're going to be playing Sisterhood of the Magical Blade, which is an anime game of magical girls and swords. And girls with magical swords. Anyway, it's going to be awesome. Come around for that. And yeah, like I said, next Friday, we're not going to have a Cyberpunk. We're going to have one the Friday after, probably, or in 2 weeks. Before I leave, I have a question. Aside from if everyone had fun and everything, but now that we've managed to get the rules for card gen, we're gonna have our new characters built up for our season 2 and everything, I would like to know, what would it take for us to actually play with Morgan Blackhand?
Hey, have a good night. We're looking at you, Jay. We're looking at you.
Have a good night, Chumbas. We'll see you in a couple of weeks. Bye-bye. To me, you're wrong.